Welcome to The Power of Rhythm, a podcast with your host, Reinhard Flatischler, founder of Mega Drums, Taketina Symphonic, and a worldwide network of groundbreaking rhythm training. This podcast will offer you an incredible diversity of voices around the one thing that connects us all. Rhythm.
Hi and welcome to episode 33 of my podcast. And if you believe you know what a singer can do with her voice, this episode really might surprise you. So sit back, relax, and listen to some music only a super talent can provide. And my guest today certainly falls in that category. Her life is defined by the healing power of music and by the mission to show the world the rhythmic power of voice. In her music, countless influences merge into a unique style, from medieval music to bebop, from world music to avant-pop, and from conacol to free voice rhythms. And since 2018, she's collaborating very closely and extensively with Academy Award winner, composer Hans Zimmer and James Newton Howard. Recently, she released her debut album, 18 Wings. That's dedicated to her father, who passed away when she was a teenager. And the album also features Trio Globo with the Grammy Award winning artists Glen Velez, Howard Levy, and Eugene Friesen. Welcome, Loire Cotler.
Thank you, Reinhard. It is such a pleasure to be here, to meet you face to face. I feel that we've been all following each other around for centuries and thousands of years, and now we're just catching up with each other.
Exactly. What a pleasure. Now, inside you, there are many different Loires. There's the performer, there is the educator, there's the therapist, there's the composer. And I hope we can kind of cover most of those aspects of you in this episode. Now let's start with one thing that seems very important for me. Let's just give the listeners a reference point. What are we talking about? Where are we going to? And so with that, I want to start with you being the rhythmic voice. That's Loire Cotler. Wow, Loire Cotler in fire. Now, I have been studying tabla and bakawaj in India and have really met quite famous drummers, but I have hardly seen this precision that comes out of your voice. That's amazing. It's just amazing. How did you get there?
You have to go very slow.
Okay, study slowly, yeah.
Slow, slow, slow. And for me, it's all about the two vital life force energies, you know, breath and pulse. And I know that you do this in your work, you know, reducing it to the most simple of forms and allowing the pulse being the guide. Because if I let the mind and I let the voice be the guide, then I have nothing. I have no steadiness of the pulse. I have no deeper intention there, right? Because the thoughts and all the activity that, you know, make us unstable get in the way.
So true. Okay, let me take you first back. I'm really curious. Your very first encounter with music, when, where, what age?
It was so early on, and my parents knew from just a few years old, because we always had a piano in the house, and I just was gravitating always to the instrument. So for sure, I was born this way. I came into the world this way. But I have to tell you that what strikes me from your question is a little bit later, because I had, you know, we have these aha moments, you know. And I think I was about 11.
Oh, I know this. You met Candido, right?
And it was at my brother's bar mitzvah. It's a crazy story, which I can't even understand, but I had these encounters like I'm having right now with you, with master percussionists. And it started very early on, and it just kept going and going and going. And somehow at that year, Candido, he must have just been a friend of the band that was hired from my brother's bar mitzvah in New York. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I mean, everyone's eating and celebrating, and it's at the party, and the band is playing, you know, like, you know, big band music and whatever. And all of a sudden, and now we have this special guest, Candido, you know. And I was like, little Loire, just kind of like, what's happening? And like, this guy comes out and he just starts burning up this solo on the multiple congas with the elbow, and I was just transfixed. I was galvanized, and I just, it was, you know, at that age, you're not thinking at all. You're just experiencing, and that never left me. That like feeling of, oh my God, is that possible? I want to do that. I want to feel that, the things that he must be feeling when he's playing that instrument, the way he's doing it, the story that he's telling without the words.
Yes.
And that was it, you know, I remembered. And he passed away, you know, like just, I think he was 100 and something. But that was transformative for me, because it wasn't just music. It was rhythm.
Yeah. Yeah,
it was just that deep connection to the source of cool. the earth and the world and the whole thing. Yeah,
and for everyone,
enjoy.
Yes, enjoy. And everyone who has seen Candido is this first guy who actually, the first Cuban who used several drums, you know.
Yes,
and
yes.
He's like this force, a little bit to Babatunde Olutunji that I also met, you know, and played with, so like vroom.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. The contact to the instrument was so deep and so, you know, so authentic.
Yeah.
And so much joy. You know, like you know, the kind of joy that you hope that you can still experience, you know, through the hard life of choosing, you know, to be an artist, right? Because the artist's journey is not easy. But to always find that joy, and he got it, and he transmitted that to me.
I can so much refer to what you have experienced, because I have a similar story, if I may share it. I've been a kid who always had already, I think, 5 years old, play piano. Yeah. And I went more and more into classic. And then, 8 years old, there was this first concert with Ravi Shankar and Anuraga. And little Reinhard was there. And I was out of my mind. I said, this is impossible. How is this drum, this little drum, you know, giving all the sounds? And actually, that really was one of the transformative moments that set me on the path to, very similar to your story, actually.
Yes, yeah. So, we never know where we're going to get it, you know. And, you know, being around music was it was a regular part of my household. I had no models for it, because nobody in my family were musicians.
Really?
So, yeah.
Wow.
Just a great uncle who became a lawyer, but he had studied classical piano, was concert level pianist, but never really pursued it. And so I didn't really, except for, you know, the occasional time that I would see him, maybe the gene was there, you know, if there is such a thing as music gene, but I don't know if there is. I don't know.
Unique women and super talents are just born like this. I think you came like this. Yeah. So because I want to also play some of this beautiful music from your new album, 18 Wings. Now, 18 seems to be quite an important number in in numerology of Judaism, right? What is 18 so important about?
Yeah, so 18 happens to be also the numerological figure for the word chai, which is also meaning life. I always grew up, because I have a Jewish background, knowing about this chai thing, you know, and people would wear these little symbols and all that. But really, on a personal level, my father passed away on the 18th of February. So many years ago.
Wow.
In 1990.
Yeah,
And so when I released the album, it was the 30th. Anniversary of his passing.
Wow.
And the 18 really struck me. I since then always would be connected to that number as being a source of life, and also of what happens after. And it's just a link somehow to a day that was the worst day of my life.
Yeah.
But also some kind of holding on to some hope that there is still, you know, the possibility for connecting through my music, you know, to my father and talking with him, you know, in beyond the words again. You know, for me, that's also the theme, is beyond words. And so that's life, and it's also... you know, the symbol as well of when my father was set free from a lot of pain.
18 wings and died on the 18th. What a connection! What a way to make connections with this. And you found really good people around you, which is a real global, of course.
Of course, it was a dream. That was a dream, for sure, to play with them.
My beautiful friend, Glen Velez.
yeah. But, well, I told him, I said, if I'm making this record, my debut, as an homage to my father, because I knew that my first record would really be that. And I said that it's got to be with Trio Globo.
Now I have a quote from you that really touched me deep. Mm. It says, I quote it, "Rhythm and voice are my own wings. They are how I travel to syllables beyond thought. a subconscious language. Wow, that's deep. And so when you went to compose, arrange your music for the these 18 wings, you started with actually, I checked this out, In Walked Bud is from Thelonious Monk, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And so tell us, what is the sky pass?
Yeah, so this idea of telling a story, right? Mm-hmm. Because the voice, it's like, I don't really feel that I'm a singer. I'm not, sorry to disappoint you. I don't necessarily even feel that I have a great voice or anything like that. There's singers that are like, wow, they're like singer. They're unbelievable. They project and they have all this. My feeling is more of like the storyteller. And because I had been introduced to scat singing very early on, and that was the first iteration, which then led into the drum language, the konakal, of course, there was this immediate feeling that, could I tell a story, another side of the story through the drum language? Could I back it up? Mm-hmm. Could I back up what I just sang lyrically, mm-hmm. and maybe give another twist to it and give it like the inside view?
Okay. Who made the lyrics?
of like, because these songs from the past, right? Of course, the reason for reimagining the Great American Songbook and these bebop and post-bebop material is again the connection to my parents, for years, my mom, when are you gonna sing jazz again? When are you gonna sing something that I know, that I understand? She couldn't even, the konakal for her was like unbelievable, but she couldn't even understand what, it was kind of from the old school. So I did the jazz for them, but also taking it to this other place of, how can I, tell another story that's of these innuendos that go on in these pieces? Because a lot of the jazz material is notorious, whether it's the Cole Porter songbook or the innuendos, what they're not saying, but you feel is just so exciting for me and delight for me because I can go into the innuendos, maybe through scat singing phrases, maybe through the rhythm or the arrangements, with the guys. So
especially in this first tune, bebop and konakal, and all this comes together for me. It's like
it needed to happen.
Really,
at some
really
point,
amazing.
We had to get there, right?
Last question before we played. Who made the lyrics?
So the lyrics, so an In Walk Bud, right? It's Bud Powell.
Yeah.
And well, actually, I have all my little notes here. So yeah, so of course, I always blank out on names, but of course, really the homage here isn't just to Thelonious Monk. So when I wrote these arrangements, the homage is, of course, my father, but it's Thelonious Monk and then Bud Powell, who did the homage to Bud Powell, but John Hendricks wrote the lyrics.
Yes, I know.
One more thing, very important, the chord changes of In Walk Bud was extracted from Irving Berlin, Blue Skies.
Oh.
And so, for me, the homage is like these unbelievable, iconic musicians that when I was going to Berkeley and stuff, it was just on the loop, nonstop. Thelonious Monk, John Hendricks, Irving Berlin, Bud Powell. And so it's this kind of culmination of these great, great, important figures for music. And so John Hendricks.
I can already see our listeners go like this. Let's play.
Why already? Shut up, Loire.
No. It's so interesting. But we're building up so this curiosity.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's play that.
He was screaming next to Opie, who was beaming. Monk was thumping. Suddenly in walked Bud, and then they got into something. And Bias blew a mean sax. Mr. Max Roach beat a mean axe. Monk was thumping. Suddenly in walked Bud, and then the joint started jumping. Every hip stud really dug Bud Sunia Town. Taking that no nobody roll, putting him down. Opie pulled a mean string down and dizzy played a hip thing. Monk was thumping. Suddenly in walked Bud, and then they got into something. Oh, that doom doom, that a giddy doom, that a giddy doom, that doom doom, that a giddy doom, that a giddy doom, that doom doom, that a giddy doom, that a giddy doom, that a giddy doom, that a giddy doom.
Loire Cotler was invoked, but my God, did you arrange that in this way? Or?
I arranged it along with Glenn. We both did. It was kind of a co-arranging situation.
So I want to refer back to, you know, when you said, well, I'm not a singer. I don't feel like being a singer. I really think you are a genre in yourself. I mean, I'm honestly meaning that because I don't know any vocalist that really does something even similar to what you're doing. And the combination of how you use the rhythmic voice and how you use the melodies, I really think it's absolutely stunning and unique.
That means so much coming really? From you, from such a high caliber rhythmist as you. So I'm so grateful for your feedback. And
just brings a smile into my face. And so the next one, Bye Bye Blackbird, And that is also, I think, Ray Henderson and Mort Dixon. Yeah. And this was 1926 or so?
It was.
Very old.
And so the thing is, like, this song is really interesting. It has been interpreted so many different ways. I mean, I've heard so many, like, legends and lore about what this song really means. There was even, like, a propaganda version of it, which I don't remember the name of the band at the moment, but there was like, in a German propaganda version of this. Like, you gotta see it. It's crazy, and it's chilling to the bone, of course. Mm-hmm. But, you know, yeah, so there was even that. So this song has been through the ringer. Mm. It's been through so much. You know, already. And I thought, oh, God, you know, do I have to do this song? You know, like, it's already been through so much. But, you know, the reason is because this song had such an important, like, when I was learning jazz, okay, so when I was in high school, I went to a performing arts high school outside of New York City in Long Island. And excuse me. And so I thought, like, I was introduced to this song by my first jazz teacher, Dave Burns Sr., great trumpeter, played with Duke Ellington, Count Basie. He was in all the army big bands. And so how lucky that I had this jazz teacher to introduce me to improvisation and all the greats.
Okay, Laurie.
Rabbi Blackbird, yes.
Let me ask you one thing. You have been living in New York all your life. You've been grown up there. Yeah, it's kind of a privilege, because how can you meet all of these people, and how can you be around all of these people and also get that heritage, you know?
I think that it's true. And we could get to this later, but I only went to India just a few years ago.
Oh.
Everyone thought, oh, she must have lived in India. She must have been. No, because, you know, all the teachers, you know, would come to New York or New Jersey, you know, and teach. And so I'm spoiled musically, very spoiled musically, just by living in New York, being born there. So my teacher, Dave Burns, introduced me to Bye Bye Blackbird. Mm-hmm. And it was a song that just represented for me a period of time that was of incredible pain. My father was very sick all through my high school years, and music was my healer. I mean, it was like it sounds so cliche, because we all have had this journey of saying, thank God for music, it saved my life. But it really did, you know. It's not a cliche, it's like real. It's so deep and so absolutely, you know, essential to so many of us just making it, right? And that period was my immersion into jazz and into these songs. And Bye Bye Blackbird was like one of the first ones that I started delving into.
Wow.
And so the 18 Wings part of Bye Bye Blackbird is reimagining it into this 18 beats cycle, these playing with nines and 18, going into that mystical realm of the numbers and seeing what happens. And again, you know, connecting with my father.
That is the time where we want to listen to it also. Okay. That is Bye Bye Blackbird.
No one here loves me or understands me. Oh, what hard luck stories they all hand me. Doom ta dee da doom ta ga dee. Doom ta ki da doom ta ka dee me doom. Pack up all my care and woe. Here I go, singing low. Bye, 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 blackbird.
the most creative version of Bye Bye Blackbird I've ever heard. Loire Cotler, really, really amazing. And you can clearly hear the presence of Glen in it also very much.
Totally.
And that brings us to this point, because the last Megadrums tour that Glen and I played together, I don't think you have been already connected at this point.
No, that was right. What year was that?
2000.
Yeah, right before. Because I met Glen right after 9/11. I was living downtown and I was teaching at the new school. And in 2002 of February is when I met Glen at the university I was teaching. And he was invited by the head of the program to do a guest artist. And so I met him soon after. So I knew about Megadrums and I missed it. I missed it. I can't wait for you to do it again.
Yes, actually, I put this proposal already out. And actually, I'm really wanting to have a collaboration with you and Glen in some form in the things, really. You know, when I listened to this Connor call, for me it's not even Connor call, because Connor call is Indian. But what I hear from you is kind of a drum inside you. That has so many colors. Even if you use the syllables, I don't know if you use just Connor call syllables, I cannot follow this beat, but it's really like a drum inside you. And that's, I've never heard this. That's great.
Thank you. I appreciate that, because hearing it from you also, you know, I don't need permission, but because we have to be careful, because these are very rich lineage of classical material. Mm-hmm. And as soon as we start to step out a little bit, we have to be careful, because it might be offensive, you know, for the real traditionalists, right? But I don't call myself a classical, singer or Carnatic classical singer. I learned the konakal. I learned the system with the talas and everything. And I'm still learning. I'm still a beginner. I have so much to learn. As soon as we get into all the subdivisions and that, I have life work ahead of me of that. But the syllables are mostly from the classical, from the Solkhatu, right? Yeah. But because I have also the scat background, which means improvisatory, creating your own language to be able to express the phrases, I've adjusted so many. So even in Bye Bye Blackbird, you heard, so you have like, doom ta ki ta doom ta ka di mi doom ma ta doom ki ta doom ta di ki ta ta ka doom ta ka di mi ta ka di mi doom ma doom ma di mi ta ka ta ka doom ki ta ta ka doom ta di ki ta ka ta di ki ta ka doom na ka ta di ki ta ka na the na, right? Like the na ka ta di ki ta ka na ka ta di ki ta ka doom ta di ki ta ka dim ta di ki ta ka ta ka ta ka doom na ka ta di ki ta ka, right? So but the doom ma, right? Okay. Those are a little bit variations. The not, you hear a little bit, not as much. Mm. To me, the honor always goes to the system, right? To connect with the pulse, because it's never about just singing it. In the beginning, you know, I would just practice singing it. But then, of course, I understood very quickly that it has no meaning.
Yeah.
That this material has no meaning without its relationship to the pulse.
Yeah, exactly. And actually, that's what I wanted just to say. You put it in a completely new context. And for example, I also studied for many years Django in Korea. And I studied it properly. I can also play Korean rhythms. But I think it's important we take it to another level, because I'm not Korean, so I'm creating new rhythms with it. And so I think this is very appropriate to pay respect, but then also take it to another level. And that's what exactly what you're doing.
And the collaboration, you know, because it's like saying, okay, here we are together, all of us, yes. Right? And there's how do we share the space?
Right.
And the most beautiful way for me has been to share the space through these music connection. And that kind of exchange has led to so many new creative ideas that I don't even have enough time, you know, it feels like to get them all out, right? This, we always feel like we're on the edge of our seat, like, oh, like listening with you today made me say, I want to play with Reinhard. I want to make music live. You know, we just like, I can't wait, you know? And so, but when I teach, you know, it's so important to show the source material, whether it's to the Carnatic roots, whether it's to Glenn, or to my teacher, Dave Burns from high school, or my teachers in college, you know, or to my Konakol, to Subhas Chandran, rest in peace, you know, who I learned Konakol with as well. Showing the homage, but then also encouraging, find your way and let's you know, let's play. So and see where we go.
For me, with Loire and Glen, this is a unique combination of two completely authentic people, originals. Like, I mean, I've never also met a drummer like Glen. When he came first, and he, okay, we have four rhythms, so he put a rattle in his foot and he played.
I don't understand it.
Whoa!
It's even cool. In the what you just heard, right? Of course, you know, the nine, I can only go so far, right? I mean, it's pretty clear that some of those polyrhythms that started happening, whoa, you know, where is the one, Glenn? Where is the one? He goes, don't worry about the one. Feel the pulse. You'll get it. You know, don't worry about the one. And I'm like, yeah, but I want to know at least where is it, you know, so I can find it. Nobody can find the one with Glenn.
So the next one I chose is Alchemy.
Oh, and, good.
And
good,
that also has in the beginning already some kind of really...
That's all Glen. This is that. So that's a Glen composition. That was the first. I'll talk about it after.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Thank you. like a dream, like your love, like your love. Fire dying out like the sun, like your love, like your love.
That's Alchemy from Loire Cotler and Glen Velez. Incredible music. Who wrote the lyrics for that?
I did. I wrote the lyrics and the syllables and all that, and did the vocal arrangement.
That's beautiful. Now, actually, I want to make a little excurs here, because that shows that you are not only, you know, in this conical syllable. It's the reality opera with Jacob ter Wildhuis.
Oh, yeah.
Tell us a little bit about this guy, Jacob ter Wildhuis, and what was the whole project, like this reality opera?
Well, Jacob TV. He does a lot of multimedia work before it was even... He was very progressive, because before it was even popular to do so, he was working in multimedia. And finally, this opera came about. I think I premiered it with him in 2012, I believe was the first year. And then we had done many productions over the years around the world. And so he's taking the speech patterns, okay, and composing from using the speech patterns that he's hearing from various relevant news clips. Mm-hmm. Okay, it had changed different. There were different clips, different arias, actually, depending on the year, the production, and the whole idea was blurring the line between what is real. What is real and what's going on with our news. And now, of course, more than ever, we can say that he was really ahead of the time, because, you know, he was really emphasizing this brainwashing that was going on, and the looping
exactly.
Of words. There would be keywords, buzzwords that we would just hear over and over and over and over again until we couldn't even, you know. All right, so he would take the speech patterns and compose these amazing pieces. And so he brought me in and said, look, what I do with sampling, I think you might actually be able to do live because of your techniques and stuff. Yeah. And so it involved a combination of scored music, which, you know, was all scored with certain lyrics, and then some pieces. I'm not sure which one you're going to play first,
I'll choose two. One is the Bounce and Decline, and the other one is the You Know What. Is it the same opera? Is it the same performance?
Yeah, same. It all comes from this opera, and like Bounce or Decline, that was like the stock market. you know, and like the ticker tape, you know, of the numbers and, you know, is it rising? Is it falling? Is it going to bounce? Is it going to decline? Yeah. You know, and we're obsessed watching the numbers and going up and down and da, da, da. And he said, you know, can you write a conical like version of what that would be? The nonsense, the craziness of it. Yeah. I'm like, yeah, let's do it. So that's how that one came about. And then the other one, the You Know What, is, you know, again, it's like, you know what?
Yeah.
You know what? Yeah. You know what? Yeah. Yeah. And then it was just this kind of looping going on. But rhythmically, that was all scored. So that was hard to figure out. Very hard.
When I heard this You Know What, it reminds me really very much on Steve Reich first things, you know. He has this phasing with, you know.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, exactly. And I know that was an inspiration for Jakob. And also, you know, the scoring, there's a little like Frank Zappa vibe in there But he's a totally original composer. And it's been such a privilege working with him. And also being in a position of a composer, you know, asking of me to use all the different things that I love to do and see what I come up with.
But you made the voice rhythms, the kind of call part
of
it. Oh, yeah. So let's listen to that, because that's something people don't know really.
On the show lately, he's having trouble getting heard because as the price of oil comes down,
Where did you perform that, in New York or in...
That particular clip I think that you're playing is from Chicago, but we've done different productions, staged even very elaborately, even in the Netherlands, and with the Netherlands Rise Opera. We've done productions in LA with the Long Beach Opera. Mm-hmm. We did production at New York at the Met Museum. And they were all different, you know, because it depended on the news cycle, and also just, you know, some were more staged with costumes and that. And there was always a soprano, you know, doing the soprano lines, which was so cool and amazing to collaborate with singers, you know, doing what I do and having that, you know, beautiful, you know, symmetry of what happens when you have a classical singer singing beside, like, conical, you know. So
who's the lady singing next to you in this?
That was Josephine Stoppelberg. You can look her up. She's wonderful. She's Chicago based.
But
that's an example of non-traditional form, right? Because the form there is not carnatic. It's utilizing the rhythms. It's figuring out a way to tell the little story, go with the, you know, the arcs. It's uneven. There's some from the kita trik, that, you know, all that. Yes. And so it's a lot of fun.
It gets even much more free in the next one. And actually, that's why, with your permission, I chose those two to show, like, you know,
fabulous.
You are using words and you're using rhythm. It's amazing. So let's hear this one.
Do you know...
Piece. Yeah, it for me, it's kind of in the Steve Reich tradition, but it's so creative. Now, let's turn a little further, Laura. Let's turn to you as an educator and as a therapist. Tell us a little bit about how you, you know, what is this for you? How did you come into therapy and what did you do in it?
Well, you know, when I was in high school, during that same period of getting into jazz, I also discovered music therapy from a teacher who said, hey, you know, why don't you check out, she had like a book or a pamphlet or something. I mean, I think I was 16 years old. And she said, why don't you take a summer course in music therapy?
Okay.
And I had no idea what that was. And then I thought, I don't know what that is, but it makes so much sense to me, so I'm going to do it. And so I was very blessed to have come encountered with the thing that was already proving itself to me to be real, which is the therapeutic effect of music. Right? So I knew already intuitively that this was right, and then but I didn't understand that there was this whole clinical milieu out there. And so I took a course. I was going to summer camps and all that every summer during those years. And then I decided that I was going to get the master's degree from NYU in music therapy. And but do music also, continue to study and grow musically. I didn't have really any goals except to just be in music in every single way possible. It wasn't like, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. It's like, no, let's just jam and keep learning and growing. And let me also see what this music therapy, if I could be good at it, in terms of the healing, working with people. And so I did all of my work in psychiatric hospitals and clinics around New York City. And, you know, I think that that work has the most impact still on a lot of the music that I do. Because, again, you know, going into this expressive nature that the voice can do, this storytelling, I can draw from a lot of the experiences that I had with the patients, which is, what is the rhythm of anxiety? Mm. What is the color of depression? What is the polyrhythm of schizophrenia? Mm. What is bipolar? What is a phrase? What is a bipolar phrase? You know, and this was the kind of, I was working in locked units.
Really?
In New York. Yeah, locked units at Maimonides Medical Center in Brooklyn. And, you know, to be around that every day and to be really up close and personal, working through music, using clinical applications of music.
So there was a time where you really day by day worked.
Yeah. It was a full-time job, and I was teaching also. So wow. I went to NYU, and then starting in 94, 95, I started working in hospitals and clinics, different ones, but later on at Maimonides was full-time. And also working with autism in children, special needs schools, and that, and having that experience, using the clinical techniques of music therapy, using the group dynamic work that I was learning. I mean, it was that in line with all the music that I was studying and learning at the same time and working on of my own music, there was no separation for me. The only difference is that I was totally, you know, not a public figure, you know, doing the music therapy stuff. And then at night I'd go, you know, out to the clubs in the village and jam out, right? And then all of a sudden I was on stage.
So,
did
you in this work with your patients also use voice?
Yes. Yeah, we'd use a lot of like toning, you know, different types of toning together, singing songs, you know, maybe utilizing favorite songs of patients in order to engage and get the relationship going. Songwriting. So I worked a lot with foster kids that and teenagers that were abandoned in New York City, their parents were drug addicts or in jail, whatever, you know, like that they were really slipping through the cracks and like the forgotten children because they're teenagers and no one wanted to adopt them. And of course, you know, I had the feeling like I would wish I could adopt, you know, there were all these, you know, things going on. And I would use writing, like I called it, you know, like clinical songwriting or music therapy style of songwriting, where we would, maybe they would be guarded, you know, in their hoods and they don't want to talk, and we'd use maybe a song that they love or an artist that they love. And then little by little, I would encourage, you know, let's write a song. And we'd write songs, and it would be a way for them to, you know, build trust and also to, you know, hopefully integrate that kind of building of their self-confidence.
Actually, I can really refer to the therapeutic work we're doing with Taketina in the clinics is the most rewarding, because what you see changing and what you see people going back to a more sane state in their lives, and then eventually even, you know, coming towards happiness.
Right. Yeah.
And so you also have been teaching a lot. So there's one thing in the Carnegie Hall Rhythmic Interconnectivity.
Yeah.
What was this program about?
You know, so that was just one of the, I had done a series of master classes through that program. But in general, I now remember what the clip is. So the inspiration, you know, where do we begin? But the whole inspiration of using birds, the bird formation that's in the V form for me, happened early on because when I understood how those migratory birds were traveling, it freaked me out.
It's so big
It totally blew my mind. Like, how are they doing that? Like, there's not a leader. They switch positions. They are cooperative. And they're sensing each other's rhythm, rhythmic, you know, upbeat, up, downward wash of the wings. And then I thought, holy shit, you know, like, that's like rhythm. I mean, that's like upbeats, downbeats, and everything in between, the space in between. And that space in between is like where we share and where we explore and where we travel, right? And so I started using the bird formation as my own metaphor for teaching. And, you know, and the idea that, you know, rhythm singing for me or being a rhythm vocalist is more of like an approach, right? It's like, let's take any piece of music and let's approach it through the pulse. Let's approach it through rhythm first or the pulse first rather than the voice, even though we're using our voice, if that makes sense. And so I would take the tala and look at that and say, oh, it's just like the wings of the bird. Down.
The grabbing of the tala.
Up, down, upward wash, downward wash, up, down, right? Like, it's like ta, ki. Ta, ta, ki, ta, right? So I was just looking at these movements, like the choreography of it, and saying, so they're traveling, you know, more efficiently in this group, farther distances, using the minimum, you know, effort, because they're traveling together. They're traveling on the lift of one another. And to me, that's just like exactly, you know, like, okay, I'm doing this thing, you're doing this thing, but actually we're doing this thing.
Yeah.
I'm not anything, we're something. That's how I always have felt. That
You said there is no leader, but you infuse intelligence into the group and you provide the feel that they can become this V kind of...
Totally. Yeah, I love that, like the group mind happens. Mm-hmm. And they even switch positions. So if one bird gets sick and falls out of the V, the others move into position. Some even go down to be with that bird, right? So there's this constant flow of energy. They're creating that vortex of wind so that they can ride the wave. And I'm like, oh, waves. We know about waves. Musicians know all about waves. That's like how we live and breathe, right? We know about upbeats and downbeats.
I wrote even an orchestral piece called Waves Upon Waves.
There it is. It's the bird formation right there.
Now, I have a little clip from you teaching at Carnegie. Let's listen to that.
I'm going to sing some phrases, and then you just sing it back. Ta din din na, ta da din din na.
Ta din din na, ta da din din na.
Ta din din na, ta da din din na. Ta din din na, ta da din din na. Ta 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 din din na ta 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 din din na a ta ta din din na ta 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 din din na ta do ta 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 ta.
did Glen teach all the time with you, or are you doing also this alone for yourself?
It's both alone. A lot of times we're, you know, each having different, like if we do like a university thing, he might be in with the percussion department. I might be with some of the drummers, some of the horn players, and some of the vocalists. You know, we separate. Sometimes we co-teach as well. Yeah. But it depends on the situation.
Because he's in this video clip.
Is he in that one? Yeah. He, you know, his method, the hand dance method, was the transformative for me. You know, I mean, I all of my rhythmic approach that's the source, right? The bird, you know, all of this other, these are just variations on the theme, but using the vocalization, using the, you know, the idea, like what I know of you, you know, we've discovered that we put things into the lower body by moving our in, and we all of a sudden feel that stability of pulse, right? Because we move away from here. And so it's in that tradition, you know.
Now, Loire, let's take quite yet another aspect of you, which is that you have collaborated so long with Hans Zimmer, which I really adore. He's a really, really genius in that. Tell us a little bit about that collaboration, please.
I'd like to start by saying something that I don't think you bring this out in me, Reinhard. You want me to?
Yes.
That I hadn't really said publicly. When I was in college, I almost switched my major, my first semester to film scoring. And so since I was a kid, cinema was like everything, you know, was my way of also switching off from music in a way. Is that sounds weird, but you know, music was just constant thing going on. I could, you know, I was constantly hearing, feeling, sensing, seeing shapes of music, colors. I have all that stuff going on. And so it was a hard thing to switch off, right? But I would go to the cinema. And even as a kid, I remember riding my bicycle and there was a little local cinema and I snuck in and the popcorn and then whatever. And I was young, I mean, really young. Mm-hmm. And I think it, you know, and I never forgot it because it was the Chariots of Fire was playing. And I heard the music, you know, the Vangelis, the score. And okay, fast forward, going into Berkeley, I thought, I'm going to be a film scoring major. Mm-hmm. But I had already gone very deep into scat singing in high school. And I knew that I saw the rest of my life in front of me. Mm-hmm. But they gave you the option. And I was listening to Hans Zimmer. And I was listening to James Newton Howard. Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh my God, you know, I want to be a film score. They inspired me so much to be able to do that depth of storytelling through these lush orchestrations and the melody. I mean, the whole thing, and genius, genius, genius. And I didn't switch my major, and I'm so glad that I didn't, because I think that if I had gone that route, maybe I would never have had the opportunity to explore my voice in such a way that eventually they would find out about what I'm doing and say, hey, come on. And so now I not only am so blessed that Hans found me through Edie Lehman Bodiker and Michael Lehman Bodiker, which is Edie is the vocal contractor in Hollywood and also a masterful singer and masterful in so many ways, and her partner, husband Michael Lehman Bodiker, another legend in the synth world. They discovered me. Hans was looking for something very specific for the first film that we worked on, and there is another one coming up. Thank goodness. I never want this collaboration to go anywhere because it continues to challenge my voice.
Yeah.
And my emotional expressions in ways that, you know, I can release creativity in another way.
No.
So,
tell me about, please, what is the Dark Phoenix? Is this from the X-Men Dark Phoenix movie?
Yeah.
Or what? Yeah?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So the movie was X-Men.
Yes.
Dark Phoenix. And then, in addition, Hans released an album record,
that's so
which
great.
Elaborates. He had I don't know how many hours of music that we all, you know, were part of for the score, and he couldn't let, you know, it was such brilliant compositions and the collaboration. It would have been such a pity if these pieces never saw the light of day. And he made sure that they saw the light of day. And so Experiments is based on the music from Dark Phoenix. They're the suites that then, you know, so.
Now let's tell our listeners that because it's Hollywood, because it's Fox, we've just a little tiny bit for you to listen to. And this is the most extreme I've ever heard. Let me first ask you, have you sped this up or is this really a voice? That's really a voice? Wow. Okay, let's listen to that. Unfortunately, that's as much as we can play right now.
It's a lot. It's a lot.
But let our audience know where can they find this album to, you know, they can listen to the whole thing.
Oh, yeah. You can go any platform. They can buy or download or stream Experiments from Dark Phoenix, Hans Zimmer, or Dark Phoenix. The original soundtrack as well has a lot of really beautiful, you know.
And all this will naturally be on the description, on the podcast, so people can follow all what we have covered so far. And we have really...
It's emotional, you know, listening to that, because that is an example of how Kona. Yeah, I mean, I'm using Kona call layers, and
when I listen to this first, the whole thing, you know, it just followed me everywhere because it's so magic. You know, it's very simple, but then these things come out with these voices. My God. So for me, this is genius music, really.
Hans, you know, well, I can't say it enough. I mean, you know, of course, we all know he's a genius composer, but also masterful at leading me to release the emotion that is needed for the character. And the character in this case, which I wanted to tell you about, is Jean Grey, the X-Men character Jean Grey. And in this movie, she's wrestling with the voices in her head. So in a lot of ways, I actually had to draw from my work with people who had schizophrenia, who were fighting with this daily, inner war going on. And so the character is having this, you know, this battle going on. She's riddled with the voices, right? Fighting it. So in the beginning, you know, it was like, nobody ever sang rhythms like that. You know what I mean? You would not hear that, right? With this material that you know very deeply, right? Okay, so again, you know, how do you do that? So it's like screaming at the top of your lungs.
Yeah, yeah. When it's
cathartic, you know, to do that, but in time with the click. You know.
Yeah, when I listened to this first, and this is this nice atmosphere, all of a sudden these voices come out. They go so deep because you can't grasp exactly what it is. And then, of course, I knew this is your voice, but then I couldn't believe, is it really your voice? It was so fast. All this coming out.
Sometimes for the layers, you know, and I don't want to give away too much of the secret of, like, you know, some of that stuff. But because, again, a lot of it is, I mean, you know, Hans's composition, it's like he might give me something to work with, right? He's giving me suites and giving me, you know, the notes to work with. And then I'm like, how am I going to say? And looking at the metronome marking, like, oh, fuck, how am I going to? That's fast, you know? And, but you figure it out because it's like the greatest, you know, challenge in the world. And also he's you know, you want to please someone like Hans Zimmer so badly, because he's so passionate and so much joy and excitement about the music making and the collaboration and that. And, you know, at some point he just said to me, you're very kind by nature, but now I need you to flip the coin and give me nasty, you know, give me mean and, you know, and be a bitch and, you know, and all that. I'm like,
okay,
got it. And then that's, you know, you're hearing that, but then, you know, to do it in time and, and find the syllables. But if you listen closely, Nakita is the, so the screams in the background, obviously the, you know, all of that is the traditional, but the Nakita, 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 it's this dialogue between negative, 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 but negative, negative. That's how fast it is, right? But to do it, and they have it mixed down, but the raw track of it, screaming it at the top of my lungs.
Wow.
You know, and the tears coming out and you're just
emotions
giving everything.
You can
you're
hear.
Giving it, you know, because you're getting into character. So my work with Hans and now more recently with James Newton Howard is really about coming full circle. My love of the cinema, but my passion for film scores, having listened to them, listening to old film scores for so long and wanting to be behind the scenes, not on stage, but really be completely invisible and go into this this magical world of creating characters and colors and that. So it's a dream come true.
Did you record it in Hollywood?
Yeah, I did some of it in Hollywood, in Santa Monica at Remote Control Productions. And a lot of it remote, you know, recording in a studio out here that I work with the same engineer for 15 years, Kostadin Komsev, incredible engineer. And I work with him doing a lot of remote projects over the years, session work. So I've been able to work remotely, thank goodness, through the pandemic because, you know, we had the plexiglass and work, you know. So.
But then I hope really that this ends soon because I want you to come over here again. And this is a real wish. We will actually do something together.
Yeah, we will. I know that we will because there's hope now. There's hope. There's a lot of hope. I think in the beginning, I never lose hope. But the main thing was, you know, all of us just staying, making it through this, you know, in one piece because so many people didn't. And, you know, and I it's been such a horrible, how many months now?
I came back a year ago from Brazil and since then I'm here, but I've done a lot of great things here. And so hoping that this eases out now. And my God, we could go forever. It's so amazing with you. Now, thank you so much.
It's such a privilege, Reinhard, really. This has been magical to be with you finally, you know, and talk rhythm and everything else and connect.
Yeah, and thank you for all you have shared with us. It's such an abundance. Thank you so, so much, my dear. Now, just tell our listeners where can they find you on the internet and...
Oh, I hope they just find me on your podcast.
Yes, but...
Because that's what's happening right now, and that's the best. And then, of course, just loirecotler.com and, you know, all the usual stuff.
Absolutely favorite episode for me so far. And so, you know, I hope for you listeners, too, that you have seen, my God, what can someone do with their voice? And what's the beauty in this whole thing? And the whole range from, you know, teaching, doing therapy, going out and performing, and then ultimately... Mrs. Hollywood, here you go. Even this is here. It's beautiful, it's beautiful. Thank you so much. And all your listeners following us, If you like the podcast, go to powerofrhythm.com/podcast, leave a comment, and if you like a certain artist, let me know. For now, all the best, and keep on grooving.